This Japan-exclusive PSP title,
a Japan-exclusive add-on,
Japanese PlayStation 1 exclusive,
only in Japan.
If you've watched my channel for any amount of time, you will know that I have an affinity for mysterious games. This manifests most of the time as an interest in the games that never left Japan. Titles refused a translation and left to rot as cultural oddities and expensive imports. Luckily for me, the past 5 years has seen a surge in interest regarding games of the sort, and subsequently, the amount of fan translations that have emerged to breathe new life into such titles has skyrocketed. However, and for obvious reasons, not every Japanese game that one could form a weeabooistic fascination with has been or even will be translated by a selfless group of dedicated fans. This has left monolingual, English-speaking, obscure game enjoyers such as myself in an awkward position, wanting so desperately to play and experience these games that we have become so enamored with, though not having the knowledge, linguistically, to fully grasp the intentions of these pieces of art. One could decide to harass fan translators on Twitter in an attempt to get them to finally localize that one game we've wanted forever. However, in my personal experience, they haven't responded too favorably to such poking. And in the time you'd be waiting for them to reply or give you an update on their current project, you could probably learn enough Japanese to experience most untranslated games firsthand. Though, for me at least, life always seems to get in the way of that latter possibility. A couple things before we start. Please don't harass fan translators on Twitter or anywhere else for that matter. I mean, they've got enough on their plates. And secondly, please ignore the change to my hair and general appearance. This video has taken a long time to make, and the video's still the same. The change in hair won't affect your viewing experience. Oh, and please don't forget to like this video, comment any thoughts you have down below, and subscribe to the Any Button to Start channel. Anyway, now on with the video. My long-running insistence that I'm too busy to learn Japanese has led me down some odd paths to play the laundry list of untranslated Japanese games that I have developed a curiosity for. These paths include making a whole 10-minute video essay simply begging for someone more linguistically diverse than myself to translate the 2001 Dreamcast exclusive Seigagaga. Now, that video took around 30 hours to make from conception to upload and has yet to yield much of anything for myself or anyone else, and the last time I checked, Seigagaga still stands untranslated. After that fiasco, I needed a quicker solution for my problem, so returned to my internet toiling. On Twitter a while later, I came across a tweet from friend of the channel and actual real-life fan translator, Burnt Ends. The tweet referenced a feature in open-source emulation front-end Retroarch that I realized in that instance could just be the solution I needed for my ongoing literacy issue. Screenshots of notoriously untranslated Dreamcast title Sakura Wars 3 were displayed with strange, unaligned English text boxes patchwork pasted over the game's UI. The words accompanying these images read, "Since everyone's been telling me they got back into playing Cyberpunk, I decided to play Sakura Wars 3 for the first time with an AI translator." That third image kinda sus though. My first thought, they were right. That third image was kinda sus, though thinking on it a second longer allowed me to realize what I was looking at. A piece of technology that could, to someone like me, be the key to a world of video games heretofore incomprehensible. RetroArch's AI translation tool, which takes screenshots of the game you're currently running, sends it to a server to be passed through and then returned in a matter of seconds, translated from any language to any language, was my Disney World fast track to all the oddball Japanese exclusive video games taking up space in my mind and on my hard drive. This notion sent me into a frenzy of setting up bios and private servers, so much so that I didn't return to the words of that tweet again until sitting down to write this video. So, whilst Past Me troubleshoots the emulators, let us discuss the true implications of Burnten's tweet. Lord forgive me, I'm about to explain the joke. The first thing Burnt Ends makes us aware of within this tweet is the sudden resurgence of Cyberpunk 2077. Stick with me here, this is going somewhere. The infamous first-person, open-world, big-budget RPG by CD Projekt Red recently received a Netflix original anime spin-off, Edgerunners. And subsequently, the game experienced a surge in active players that almost matched its launch numbers. This, of course, is relatively unprecedented in the world of the AAA, though when I learnt about this, I couldn't help but draw parallels to the sorts of games and the stories about those games that I tend to cover on this channel. I was reminded of something like Racing Lagoon, a game that had been and gone in terms of relevancy that, due to its evocation in a later, completely separate piece of media, had a resurgence in popularity and eventually, players. Obviously, Racing Lagoon's story played out on a much smaller scale and longer timeline than Cyberpunk's and was simply inaccessible before its fan translation to a majority of its eventual second wave of fans and players, so no one can blame it for taking a little longer to take off than one of the biggest games of the past decade. Yokohama's Fastest Legend. The second half of the tweet, to I think everyone's surprise, actually did reinforce a connection to the world of the untranslated. When I first read this part of the tweet, I had not yet heard of this AI translator feature, but from its name and the screenshots, I instantly knew exactly what it was. I also understood why Burnt Ends had used Cyberpunk as a humorous point of juxtaposition when announcing a playthrough of a never-localized game like Sakura Wars 3. What this playthrough represented was a step towards a cyberpunk future within our own reality. The RetroArch feature itself constitutes consideration, at least speculatively, as a true piece of cyberpunk technology. A feature that promises near instant translation of any game thrown at it, now that's some serious power. My mind raced with all of the games I now may be able to taste due to this technology. Forbidden flavors suddenly laid bare, ready for devouring. I also knew that this technology did not just have implications for the individual gamer, but also the collective obscure game community. I realized that with this feature, the potential for grassroots relevancy revivals like we saw with Racing Lagoon grew exponentially. The tearing down of perhaps the most inherently gatekept aspect of localization, the actual translation, might make it so more people feel inclined to take up the Herculean task of fan translating an old game. As I stared closely at those screenshots, the relative coherence of the translated text gave me hope that this technology was just as game-changing as I had theorized. And with that, I knew I had to give it a try. My first port of call when testing out this AI translator for myself was putting together a list of games to test the feature on. I specifically wanted to try out games that have never been localized, officially or un, and that do not have upcoming fan translations. Firstly, because I don't want this AI's probably slightly broken reinterpretation of the original Japanese text to stand in for the hard work of actual localizations, and secondly, to test the feature's viability in delivering a comprehensible experience for first-time players. With this in mind, I came up with three games to focus my research on. Tokimeki Memorial 2, Sakura Wars 2, and Boku No Natsuyasami 2. Lots of twos, I guess. These games are all extremely text-heavy, hence their inclusion, but I also chose these specific titles due to the fact that each one of their previous series entries has been, or at least is about to be, fan-translated. I wanted to test whether someone fresh off a playthrough of the fan-translated first games in the series could follow the plots of their sequels. And chances are, if you're watching this video, you have wished for a fan translation for at least one of these games. I know I have, for all of them. So let's stop wasting time and get on with our testing, shall we? Tokimeki Memorial 2 was the first game I decided to try the feature out on, mainly due to the fact that, unlike some games, attempting to play this one sans knowledge of the Japanese language is near impossible, so I thought I'd take my chance whilst I could. Before I tell you about my experience, I must briefly explain my setup for the translator. I had the screenshots being sent to the AI through a private server as to speed up return times for text. To actually begin the translation, I had the letter J on my keyboard assigned as a hotkey. And for Tokimeki Memorial 2 at least, I had the pause when translating option set to off, as I knew the text boxes in the game weren't auto-scrolling, meaning the translator could have all the time in the world to work its magic, and I could still listen to that sweet, sweet background music. When first booting up TM2, I was immediately met with the first obstacle, speaking. Yes, Tokimemo 2's opening cutscene is narrated in its native language of Japanese with no subtitles or text boxes. So, within the first 2 minutes of my testing, I had found a fatal flaw with the feature. It only translates text. When initially learning of the technology and its capabilities, I, for some reason, didn't realize that this would cause issues. But with this incomprehensible cutscene playing out in front of me, I felt foolish for not clocking beforehand. Of course, many games one would want to play with this AI translator have cutscenes or sometimes even gameplay dialogue that isn't written down either in subtitles or text boxes, rendering the AI useless for those scenes. Perhaps one day it will be able to translate voice acting as well, but for now, I was stuck misunderstanding. Luckily, the next cutscene the game shows the player, the opening theme's music video, does indeed have its song lyrics subtitling the scene. Though as I hovered my finger over the J key, I was near certain that the lyrics were going by too fast for the AI to keep up with. Despite that, I clicked, and exactly 2 seconds later, a black, utilitarianly unglamorous English text box popped into existence in the space directly in front of the game's subtitles. I read the text and clicked the J key again to clear the screen as the Japanese subtitles changed. I was in awe. Within this second instance of ever trying the feature out, it had proved to me, in no uncertain terms, its worth. As the song continued, I translated each line as it appeared and, to my surprise, was completely able to follow the lyrics, despite some grammatical errors. Things were looking up. The game started proper, and to no one's surprise, the AI couldn't handle the name entry screen, though that's not too important. As mentioned previously, the text boxes in TM2 do not automatically continue, so the AI was given ample time to translate each line. However, the first few results it spat out didn't give me much faith that that time was being used constructively. 138 frames after pressing J on the first of Tokimeki Memorial 2's many lines of dialogue, I was presented with two text boxes, more than slightly overlapping each other and neither perfectly aligned, though the bottom one had done a better job than the top. The first read FIFA Hinoshita, Achan. These words are nonsense, I mean, clearly. However, the second box was more legible. Let's go home together. Of course, confusion was the first emotion to flood my brain, but as I stopped and stared harder, it was obvious what was trying to be said and why the AI had screwed it up so thoroughly. When picking a name for my character, I spammed the X button over the Japanese hiragana character, A. So my character's name translated to Ah. This explains Achan. Though FIFA Hinoshita, I have no explanation for. Despite the confusion, a large chunk of this translation, when taken alongside the context clues of the game's graphics, I felt confident enough that I understood what was happening, so I pressed the X button to continue. The rest of this extended opening played out in much the same way. Imperfect translations that were just comprehensible enough for me to follow the story. Once the game reached its first 3D exploration section, I was concerned that it was going to get a lot worse comprehension-wise, though to my surprise, it only got a little worse, and I managed to make it through the 3 in-game days of this section with a relatively firm grasp on what was happening and what I was supposed to do. It wasn't exactly hassle-free, however, and of course, my brain was working harder than if reading an actual translation. Many of the generated text boxes displayed random letters or numbers at the beginning or ends of sentences. Often pronouns would get switched around from text box to text box by the AI, and occasionally the AI would just refuse to translate certain text, no matter how many times the hotkey was pressed. All of these issues, and a few others, made following scenes and the general narrative of the game quite difficult at times. Though, despite this, I made it through the entire opening chapter of Tokimeki Memorial 2 with nothing but the help of this AI translator. And I believe I got more than the gist of what was going on. I probably would have played further if the AI didn't die at the first sight of the activities menu, but hey, couldn't be perfect. The next game I tested the tool on was Sakura Wars 2, another visual novel-esque dating sim, though one with a wildly different structure from Tokimemo, and plus, games like this have a lot of text and basically live and die depending on the player's comprehension, so they are the perfect games to throw at this AI. In between this test and the previous, I had actually learnt a trick regarding the AI and manipulating its placement of the text boxes. According to Burnt Ends, remember, from before, the AI doesn't work too well with high internal resolutions. What this means for the layman is that to get well-aligned text boxes with the most accurate translations, one is want to keep the picture quality within the emulator to the original settings of the console. For games with mostly 2D elements such as Sakura Wars 2, raising the internal resolution really doesn't give much benefit in terms of overall picture quality, so for this test, I decided to keep the emulator at native resolution to see how much this affected the text box placement. And I won't leave you hanging either. This really helped. Almost immediately, I noticed that the text boxes I was getting for Sakura Wars 2 at internal resolution were near perfectly aligned compared to the ones shat out by the AI for the up-resed Tokimemo 2. This gave me hope for better results within this game, but also made me realize a major flaw with this feature in its current state. Obviously, for anyone using emulators, little tricks and quirks like this are standard when trying to get old games to run well. Though for the average consumer, simply interested in checking out a game they may have seen a screenshot of online, this sort of minute tinkering and word-of-mouth tech support would be a major barrier to entry. Whilst this tip from Burnt Ends made my experience easier and more enjoyable, I can imagine that to most, a quirk in the system like this may just turn them off entirely. If this feature ever wants to see mass adoption, issues like these need to be streamlined on the user end. Anyway, back to the game. As I played through the intro, I was quietly impressed with how well the AI was handling Sakura Wars 2. I had turned the pause when translating option on for this game, as its signature conversation mechanic, the lip system, is timing based, and I wanted to give the AI all the time it needed to translate the selection of possible answers to, in turn, give myself the best chance at not pissing off the cast of girls. Whilst the constant stop and start of the music as the AI went to work did slightly mess up the pacing of scenes and conversations, I can't help but think that having the option on improved the quality of the translations. Of course, there were still minor issues with random letters and numbers appearing in text boxes and the odd phantom line of dialogue that the AI didn't want to touch, but with Sakura Wars 2 and its native internal resolution, the AI seemed to shoot out much more consistent results than with the previous game. The one constant annoyance was the AI's insistence of translating text or what it thought was text in the actual backgrounds of scenes. I found myself longing for an option to limit the translation to text boxes only, as to not obstruct the game's beautiful artwork and environments, but alas, the relative rudimentariness of the feature and its lack of preference options meant that this was an impossibility. Apart from the problems just stated, the visual novel-esque sections of Sakura Wars 2 were handled with far more grace by the AI than the similar sections in our first game. However, Sakura Wars is a series of two halves, and accompanying the dating sim sections are isometrically viewed traditional strategic turn-based battles. Obviously, I needed to see how the feature would handle this far more dynamic and action-packed portion of the game, so I waited with bated breath for the first battle. It finally arrived after about an hour of testing, and as the screen transitioned to the battle view, I was ready to see how well the test was going to go. The first enemies started to move on the field, setting the stage for the battle. I waited for a text box and It didn't come. The enemies stood, looping their idle animation, much in the same way I sat, bated breath, eyes glued to the screen. I engaged the fast forward feature on the emulator to see if this was just an uncannily long transition in animations, but the screen stayed the same. I reloaded the save state. The same thing happened. I reset the emulator and reloaded a memory card and still, nothing. I then ended the recording and, in a panic, restarted my computer and started messing with the emulator settings. After a couple of days of troubleshooting, I realized I wasn't going to fix the issue before I wanted this video out. So, with a heavy, heavy heart, I ended my Sakura Wars 2 test and noted this down as a major obstacle in using the AI translator. I started my testing for Boku No Natsuyasami 2 feeling slightly dejected. The abject failure of about 50% of my previous test didn't leave me confident for this final one. Regardless, I loaded up the game at native internal resolution, left the pause when translating option on, and hoped for a better time. Before clicking J on the title screen, I silently placed a bet with myself that Boku no Natsuyasami 2's choice of logo font would cause the AI to, in some way, screw up the title's translation. With bets placed, I pressed the hotkey, and by some divine act of motivation, the AI returned the title screen with a text box displaying its widely used folk-translated title, My Summer Vacation. Of course, the AI misses the double entendre of the word boku being both a first-person pronoun in Japanese and the player character's actual name, but it would need a lot of context to come up with a translation that encompassed that double meaning, so this simpler translation is both expected and understandable. Slightly more infused than 2 minutes previous, I started a new game.
That slight spark of hope was quickly stubbed out, however, as the game's opening cutscene, like Tokimeki Memorial 2's, had no subtitles. I was stuck, baffled once again. Boku No Natsuyasami 2's lack of cutscene subtitles had left me and the AI holding our proverbial controllers, whilst narrative incomprehensible to us played out without stopping to check who it had left on the shore. So, we waited. One of the reasons I wanted to test Boku No Natsuyasami 2 in particular for this video is that the game's text boxes are, quite unconventionally, oriented vertically along the right side of the screen, instead of the usual horizontal bottom of the screen placement. I was curious to see how the AI would interpret the vertically descending text of Boku Natsu 2, and if the placement of the AI's English text boxes would complement the game's now iconic subtitle presentation. With this in mind, I tentatively watched the game transition from its opening credits to the first of its in-game story sections. With finger hovering over the J key, the first subtitle appeared. And just as I had noticed it and went to press, the subtitle changed. I did end up pressing J and the game did pause, though the AI was now translating the second line of dialogue, having completely missed the first. In that instance, I knew there was no way for me to bring that first line of dialogue back onto the screen, and I also realised that Boku No Natsuyasami 2's movie-like subtitles might just move a little too fast for myself and the AI to keep up with. Just as that thought had finished ringing out in my head, the first translated text box appeared, and with it, so did another problem. The AI's text box's resolution is determined by the internal resolution set for the emulator. This had not presented any problems thus far, as Sakura Wars 2, even at 480p native resolution, has large, well-defined characters within its Japanese text boxes, meaning that the AI spat out similarly sharp and large English characters. Boku No Natsuyasami 2, however, displays its Japanese text in a much thinner and smaller font, meaning that, unfortunately, the first text box I was shown by the translator looked like this, and was practically unreadable. Disappointment surged in me once again. I clicked J on the next few lines to similar results, and eventually decided to say screw you to text box placement, and up the internal resolution to my monitor's native of 1440p. I restarted the game and returned to that first, initially unreadable line of dialogue. When the AI eventually spat back its results, I was surprised. The placement was almost identical to the lower res version, and comparing the two text boxes, the translation seemed to be the same. I was a little suspicious that the AI had just gotten the translation wrong both times, as it did seem a little nonsensical, but as I pressed J again to continue the scene, that suspicion was instantly proven wrong, as the spoken line of dialogue matched exactly with the translation. I continued attempting to translate this first scene, though kept on running into the issue of speed. Unfortunately, Boku No Natsuyasami 2's subtitles come and go too fast for me to reliably pause to translate on each one, so lines kept on slipping through. However, and perhaps more importantly, when assessing the AI's ability to seamlessly integrate with any game thrown at it, the stop-start nature of its attempt at Boku Natsu 2 loses it major points. As alluded to earlier, the Boku No Natsuyasami series goes for a more cinematic presentation, and this extends to its dialogue. The characters speak in short, naturalistic sentences, and the pace of conversation is fast and snappy. This, of course, is why I was having trouble catching each subtitle to translate. Though, even when I did translate an uninterrupted string of text, the pausing of the game for the AI to catch up totally killed this cinematic pacing, and hence diminished one of the game's defining artistic features. By the time the game gave me control of Boku, the player character, I felt exhausted and dejected. I walked around this lovely Japanese seaside home for a while and eventually put down the controller and closed the emulator. Though technically the AI performed probably at its peak with this final game, the concessions I had to make as a player when it came to experiencing Boku no Natsuyasami 2 were too great for me to ignore, and I knew that I was slightly bastardizing the game for myself. It made me think that no matter how advanced the actual AI technology gets and how accurate its translations become, it will never truly seamlessly integrate with any one game. Any game played or experienced with the help of this AI will always have an asterisk next to it in the player's mind. Unfortunately, there will always be interruptions and misunderstandings. I've had an extremely tough time writing the end to this video. The most obvious thing for me to do is to wrap everything up and tell you that whilst this AI translation technology is fascinating and signals big innovations for the future, currently, the AI's unnuanced results that lack any human context leave the experience feeling far from ideal. To me right now, however, that feels incomplete. I went into the research process for this video, genuinely hoping that this feature may just be the key to all the untranslated games that I've been desperate to try out. But with closer examination, I've realized that that possibility is still a long way off. I'm now left feeling as though my time could have been spent better on other endeavors. Perhaps I should have examined why it was I wanted to play these linguistically foreign games when there are veritable boatloads of games fully playable in English that I have still yet to play. Or instead, I could have gone deeper with my introspection and wondered why I hadn't spent all the time used making this video to, you know, learn Japanese. I started learning Japanese in early 2019, in preparation for 9 months living in Tokyo come the new year. By my departure date, I had memorized all hiragana and katakana, and was beginning to gain a grasp on the grammar of the language, all through personal study. When in Tokyo, I would attend dedicated language classes for English speakers, and most likely due to the cultural immersion I was experiencing, I began to pick up the Japanese language rather rapidly. 2 months later, the pandemic hit, and I rushed home out of fear, cutting my trip short. The last thing I wanted was to get stuck somewhere that wasn't home, so then and now I think it was the right decision, but man, did it burn. Like the rest of the world, lockdowns weren't particularly productive for me, and hence I fell out of the habit of daily study. At first, I would practice a couple of times a week whenever I felt up to it, though very quickly, the times between study sessions started to get longer and longer. By the time I started making YouTube videos, I had all but forgotten my ambitions of bilingualism. However, as I began to find my channel's niche of relatively obscure Japanese video games, the problem of not speaking the language started to pop up more frequently than I was hoping. As I barreled towards the 2-year anniversary of my channel and began to think of the videos I wanted to make in my third year, the nagging feeling of regret started to pull at me. Maybe I should have made a stronger effort to not break my study habits and taken the free time in lockdown to continue immersing myself in the language and culture. I didn't though, and I don't think I should regret that or beat myself up about it. Instead of learning a new language, the products of lockdown for me were a wonderful, committed relationship and this YouTube channel. The most direct outlet for my creativity that I've ever had, and something that now I'm extremely proud of.
I put the effort and time that I could have put into learning kanji and understanding Japanese grammar into writing these scripts and editing these videos. I guess I decided to take the long way round immersing myself in Japanese culture. Making this particular video and testing out the AI translation tool has made me cognizant of just how much work goes into localizing a video game. To accurately translate all aspects of an inherently ever-shifting artistic medium like games into another language is a long, arduous process that demands both accurate linguistic skills and resourceful creativity to pull off. My appreciation of localization teams, both official and fan-led, has grown exponentially whilst making this video. I was so aware whilst testing the AI that the translations I was being shown lacked any human input, and then thought back to all of the well-written, spiritually faithful, and humanity-filled localizations that I have played for this channel and simply for fun. I realized that the good stuff, the juicy, memorable bits from those localizations came from the love and dedication of specialized teams. I also realized, however, that those teams could only do so much, only translate so many games, which meant that at some point, the work of localization would fall on my head. Not as in I'm going to become a fan translator or anything, but I now understand that if I want to experience all the games that could ever potentially catch my eye, that I would have to make a concerted effort to do so. It would take some elbow grease. Whether that means referencing an English language guide, just straight up learning Japanese, deploying the AI translator with a healthy dose of reinterpretation on my part, or even making a YouTube video to spread awareness about a game that I don't think enough people are talking about. There are many ways in which my work towards a game can manifest. And whilst I still hope to wake up every morning to a tweet announcing a fan translation for a game that I want to play, I now understand that that won't always be the case, and I'm ready and willing to give these games the work they deserve.